I feel it in my fingers.
Love Actually treats infatuation as love. So Love Actually, in many ways, is a movie in love with the idea of love. It doesn't have a lot of things to say about anything other than that new car falling in love feeling. But a lot of people want both sex and romance, and so we kind of rush into those things, yep, and then retroactively try and build a relationship afterwards.
But if you're trying to establish a sexual relationship, definitely do it with Rodrigo Santoro. Welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Alan Seawright, and what the Christmas?
Go big or go home. This is as big as I could get.
I'm just recycling the ugly sweater from last year's Christmas episode.
You said ugly sweater, and what I heard was bodysuit.
I'm gonna put pumpkins, man!
And I'm glad that you heard it.
I've got reindeer and trees and stars and candy canes. It's just full of wonder, and I feel very loud in this. Today we are going to be exploring Love Actually. I have so many thoughts as a relationship therapist.
Many, many thoughts about this film.
This is a movie in love with the idea of love, but it actually has no idea how to make love last.
Seems to not be great at that.
It's in love with that like new car feeling of a new relationship, right? And I'm not dumping on a movie. The fact is, it's a mixed bag.
Yeah.
Some of the relationships are terribly unhealthy and portrayed as romantic. Some of them actually are quite lovely. And so I'm going to go through each relationship from unhealthiest to healthiest. I'm gonna rank them.
Oh boy.
And I'm gonna talk about what each couple needs in order to survive in the long run.
Okay.
Number 9 is Colin and the American Girls.
Ooh.
Colin starts off as an okay character. He's sad and he's lonely and he's, you know, how's my future wife doing? Kind of pathetic. But then he gets just increasingly one track.
And gross.
And super gross.
I am Colin, god of sex. I'm just on the wrong continent, that's all.
He's all about sex. He's all about that bass. No treble. And the issue with that, sorry.
Never heard it described that way.
They had an opportunity to do something cool with him, which is he's lonely in England because he's kind of a cad towards women.
American girls would seriously dig me with my cute British accent.
You don't have a cute British accent.
Yes, I do.
True.
Well, they had a great opportunity for him to go to America, discover that that's not true, and actually learn and grow.
Oh.
Instead...
Not true in my experience.
Well, you're an American faking a British accent. I mean, there is, yes. The fact is, it just irks me that he goes over, and it just turns into like an episode of Girls Gone Wild.
Oh, it's just sleazy and gross with a bunch of actresses who, like...
Went on to much better things.
I'm sorry that this happened to you.
And then he doesn't even come home with any of them. He comes home with Harriet, the hot one, and brings a girl for his friend. It's all just terribly misogynistic.
It's super gross.
Hey, gorgeous.
So here's what Colin and Harriet would need. They would need a relationship based on something other than sex.
And accents.
Sex and accents. Sexy accents. Saxons, for short.
No.
Colin would need to actually care about Harriet as a person.
Right.
And I'm not entirely convinced there's a lot there to care about.
Doesn't seem that way.
They need to spend some time getting to know each other. So what I'm going to pull from in this episode is Dr. John Van Abbott's book, How to Avoid Falling in Love with a Jerk, is the best book I know of about healthy dating and relationships.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also going to pull from my own experiences and expertise, but Colin's going to need some time getting to know Harriet, building trust, building reliance, and seeing if they want to actually commit to each other. Because right now...
Yep, garbage.
Number 8 is Peter, Mark, and Juliet. Blech.
This is yucky.
Do you think Mark's a good friend?
No, Mark is a terrible friend.
Mark is a terrible friend. So first of all, the perv, like, the footage he shoots for the wedding.
Dude, it's so pervy. And like, why are you keeping this? I don't want to know.
For his
I
own
know,
personal use.
But I don't want to know.
It's a stocking stuffer.
Grr.
Oh, I'm sorry I said that.
Ha.
It's for his own personal use. And then when she discovers it, and she's like half weirded out and half like flattered.
Yeah.
And we're romanticizing this thing. So he does this thing where he goes to their wedding. I did like the All You Need Is Love that he set that up with
sure.
the choir and everything. And if he was doing it for his best buddy.
That's adorable.
It's adorable. But he's really doing it for his best buddy's wife.
Which is eh.
Which is super eh.
Eh.
So then he, understandably, she catches him with this secret tape that he's made, and then comes, you have to experience it to believe it.
We'll get it. Oh, hi.
Who is it?
Lie to your husband.
It's Carol Singers.
Right now she should be like...
Tell him to bugger off.
right now she should be like, no, you go ahead and tell me what this is about. Good face, Kira. Accurate.
Also, just good face, Kira.
Yeah, good face, Kira, period. You were dealt a good hand there.
Yeah, you won.
This was an interesting mashup with this song.
Yep.
Jesus would approve. Oh, no way, he wouldn't. Without any hope or... Oh,
boy.
No. No.
And at Christmas, you tell the truth.
Not if the truth is that you want to sleep with your best friend's wife. To me, you are perfect. We've never talked. I'm just talking about your physical appearance.
Although, when this was filmed, this was Keira Knightley at 17. So creepy.
Really? She was 17 when they made this?
17 when they made this.
Oh. My wasted heart will love you until you look like this. So about 90 years from now, because you're 17. And this is supposed to be sweet. Oh, stop it! Thumbs down. And she's so moved by this unrequited love. Oh, he just had to share it. We've never talked before. Well, my husband's watching the game. I guess I have a quick moment to reward him for flirting with me so shortly after my wedding, betraying his best friend.
Why? Why would you do, like, I don't understand what she's doing. I don't understand what he's doing. What I do know is this is a movie that was written by a man.
Enough. It was enough.
Enough now.
It was enough a long time ago. Ugh.
So, not good.
I'm so pissed right now. So Peter and Juliet have made vows to each other.
Sure.
Mark is supposed to be Peter's best friend, but he's completely disregarding because at best, he has genuine affection towards Juliet. At worst, it's just lust.
Right.
But he's like, well, that simply has to be expressed, and Christmas is the time to do it. And the film romanticizes this as if it's the sweet, stolen moment between them. She's never given any indication that she's attracted to him, into him, but she's going to kiss him as like a reward?
I don't get it.
And it's played like, okay, well, this is this one little stolen moment between us that's all it's going to be. And he goes, enough, enough now. And I'm like, that's selfish as hell. And now what it really is a moment that, as far as Peter's concerned, his wife and his best friend now have a lifelong secret to keep from him.
Uh-huh.
And now he's going to go over for barbecues. And like, if you're thinking beyond the movie, if Mark's coming over for barbecues,
yeah, what is the rest of their life like?
In real life, what that tends to be is a slow burn escalation into infidelity.
Probably.
That or... the truth is going to come out. It's going to ruin the friendship. The marriage is going to have a lot of work to come back, to bounce back from that. And if I were Peter, I'd be pissed.
When men failed as entirely as you have, they would throw themselves on their swords.
Well, unfortunately, I forgot to bring a sword.
This is not love. Love is respectful and selfless. Number 7 is Karen and Harry, Emma Thompson and Alan Rickman.
The two best actors in the film.
Yeah.
Maybe the two best actors on the planet at the time. We miss you, Alan Rickman.
Seriously, so much. And if I were ranking this on what's the most, the best acting and the most gripping story, this would be much near the top.
Yeah.
The reason this isn't dead last, because it's an infidelity storyline, is because you have half a faithful marriage here.
Yeah.
This is a fluffy little romantic comedy, but Emma Thompson, when she discovers, she thinks that her husband, who is just kind of laissez-faire about their marriage, has bought her a necklace.
Mm-hmm.
And then she discovers that it's for somebody else. Can we talk about the acting there, right?
It is absolutely gut-wrenching. She's been getting the little hints of, obviously the assistant being...
Shameless flirt.
I'd just be hanging around the mistletoe, hoping to be kissed.
And Alan Rickman not just immediately stamping it down and her saying...
Me is very pretty. Be careful there.
But the moment when she confronts him about it, the moments when she realizes and the moment when she confronts him are just gut-wrenching. It's just...
And so real.
So real. She's, doing what all the best actors do, which is showing you everything while trying to hide it.
Tell me, if you were in my position, what would you do?
What position is that?
Imagine your husband bought a gold necklace and come Christmas gave it to somebody else.
Carol.
I mean, would you wait around to find
Good
out
night.
If it... No, have Christmas. Would you wait around to find out if it's just a necklace or if it's sex and a necklace or if, worst of all, it's a necklace and love? Would you stay, knowing life would always be a little bit worse? Or would you cut and run?
God. I am so in the wrong. A classic fool.
Yes, but you've also made a fool out of me. You've made the life I lead foolish too. Darling! Darlings! Oh, you were wonderful, my little lobster. You were so... what is that word?
Oh, man.
Orange. Come on, I've got treats at home. That's coming.
Great writing there to undercut that with comedy and absolutely stellar performance from Emma Thompson, obviously.
Yeah.
But Alan Rickman is just, you see everything in his face. He's gutted. He feels terrible. He's also questioning, should I, you know, like, yeah. There's obvious turmoil within him. That cutaway, when she goes to talk to the kids and it cuts back to him,
mm-hmm.
and it's just him going, well, this is what I've done.
Yeah.
Is just, man, that's really good storytelling.
Because he's very successful in his career and his profession, but he's middle-aged, and he's just kind of going through the routine steps right now.
Well, and this hot young thing is obviously attracted to his power and his money.
People have affairs because they feel disconnected. They have affairs because they don't feel desired. Mm-hmm. I mean, ultimately, people have affairs because of a lack of integrity.
Sure.
But as far as stabilizing the marriage, what he needed to do, instead of turning away from his wife, was turn towards her.
Mm-hmm.
And say, hey, things are feeling kind of stale for me. I'd like to shake that up because I choose you. I want you. But we're routine right now. Now this has happened. What they need to get through this is what John Gottman calls the three keys to working through infidelity,
mm-hmm.
which is atonement, attunement, and attachment. Atonement is basically the person who had the affair takes total accountability, and the person who was betrayed gets it all out of their system, all their hurt, all their anger, all their betrayal, with the other person not getting defensive and taking full ownership, not shifting blame, and reassuring them through changed behavior. And then attunement is rebuilding and forging the bonds of love through forgiveness, but also through earning trust. And then attachment is establishing boundaries with consequences if those boundaries are violated. It's outside of the purview of this video, but I've got a mended light one right here that will tell you all about it. Number six is Sarah and Carl. So Sarah works in Alan Rickman's office, so does Carl, and she's apparently loved him for forever. Everybody knows, but she hasn't done anything about it. And here's an issue I have with how love actually treats love. Love actually treats infatuation as love. The fact is, Sarah and Carl have almost never talked.
Yeah, I mean, they've presumably spoken together at work, and, you know, they may have spent a fair amount of time together, but they certainly haven't any time outside of work done anything.
And they haven't talked about anything personal. I mean, she freezes up when he walks by. Anything right. they talk about is, hey, are we out of staplers? Or, hey, you know, it's all just work-related.
Yeah.
They don't actually know each other. But then at the Christmas party, they dance and they decide to go home and hook up. Look, I'm not knocking casual sex if everyone's, you know, on the same page or one-night stands. But apparently, if you're in love with somebody and you're trying to start a relationship, falling into bed with them is not the first step you want to take.
Does that not lead to strong relationships?
Here's what it leads to: feeling more in love than you actually are.
Ew.
'Cause you talked about in our James Bond episode, so when you engage in sexual congress with another person, brains
are... never say sexual congress again.
But our brains are wired to have feelings about that, right?
That's true, yeah.
And so when we have sex or when we hug or snuggle or kiss or make out, dopamine is released, which is pleasure.
It's just biochemistry.
But also oxytocin and vasopressin, which are bonding.
Right.
And so what ends up happening is when you get physically involved with somebody, you not only experience pleasure, you feel bonded to them.
Yep.
And so you actually feel like you're more in love than you really are. This is one of the reasons why when we get into dating relationships that are very physical, very early on, we're in love with an idea of who we think this person is.
Yeah.
And we're trying, look, we want, most of us want touch and commitment. Some people are ace, right?
Sure, yeah.
And they're not super interested in sex or romance or one or the other. But right. a lot of people want both sex and romance. And so we kind of rush into those things
yep.
and then retroactively try and build a relationship afterwards. And then what ends up happening is someone betrays us or they're not who we think they are because we were in love with who we thought they were, not with who they actually are.
I would assume this is like half of your practice, right?
Yes. Yeah. We fly in blind and then it backfires. And so what Sarah and Carl need actually is to take some time to get to know each other.
Go on some dates.
Yeah.
Like, go to dinner and just talk about crap.
Again, if you're trying to establish a long-term relationship, which
you're trying to establish a sexual relationship, definitely do it with Rodrigo Santoro.
Right. I mean, if you're trying to establish a casual sexual relationship, that's something else entirely. But she's presumably in love with him.
Right.
And so she needs to take it slower. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Van Epp talks about three things that are needed: talk, togetherness, and time. So talk speaks for itself. Togetherness is being in the same location. Because if I'm talking with somebody across the world via webcam, it's not togetherness because they're only seeing like this little controlled space. They don't see what's going on down here. They don't see how I actually live my life. They just see what I want them to see. And then time. It takes at least 90 days for someone to show you who they are. And that's if they're not actively trying to deceive you. When I went on my first date with my wife, I brought her over to my apartment for dinner. Mm-hmm. That place was cleaner than it had been in months. I dusted. I vacuumed. And she didn't come over in pajamas with no makeup and say, well, this is me.
This
like
is
everyone
it.
Puts their best foot forward. And slowly you let the walls down.
Right.
And so for them to make it, they're going to need to take some time. Next one, number five, is Billy Mac and Joe. not as much a romantic relationship.
No, it ends in a lovely place. It starts in a jerky place.
Well, the fact is Billy Mac is awful to Joe.
Sure.
And sometimes it's funny, like when Billy Mac is doing things on camera on TV shows and Joe's just...
Love is all head and...
And we just get this lovely scene where he explains why he's with Joe and not with a bunch of half-naked girls.
What was this epiphany?
It was about Christmas.
You realized it was all around?
No, I realized that Christmas is the time to be with the people you love.
Right.
And I realized that as dire chance and fateful up would have it, here I am, mid-50s. And without knowing it, I've gone and spent most of my adult life with a chubby employee. and much as it grieves me to say it, it might be that the people I love is, in fact, you.
Well, this is a surprise.
Oh, my gosh. Bill Nye is the world's greatest.
10 minutes at Elton John's, you're as gay as a maple.
No, look, I'm serious here. I left Elton's where there were a hefty number of half-naked chicks with their mouths open in order to hang out with you at Christmas.
Well, Bill...
It's a terrible, terrible mistake, Chubbs. But you turn out to be the f***ing love of my life. And to be honest, despite all my complaining, we have had a wonderful life.
Well, thank you. I mean, yeah, come on, it's been an honor. I feel very proud.
No, don't be a moron.
What these two need to do to go the distance is basically keep doing what they're doing, mm-hmm. but it wouldn't hurt for Billy Mac to use his newfound vulnerability to step into that a bit more and treat Joe with just continued respect instead of backhanded compliments mixed in with insults. It's clearly hard for him to be vulnerable, so I would encourage him to run with this now that he's taken a step into it. Number four is David and Natalie, which on sheer chemistry, they would be near the top.
Man, well, I mean, who wouldn't have chemistry with Hugh Grant, though? That dude is, like, just drips charm.
And for all the fat jokes about her and all the chubby jokes, I honestly think she's the most beautiful woman in this movie.
Listen, British definitions of fat are different from American definitions of fat, if this film is anything to go on.
And the fact is, it's all just bodies, you know? Yeah. It's all just bodies, it's all just beautiful, you love who you love. He stands up for her when people call her chubby, which I think is great.
Sure.
Then later on, he teases her about it.
God, you are alone.
Oh, shut up.
So the fat jokes haven't really aged well in this movie.
No.
He has her reassigned when the president of the United States flirts with her. I can't tell if that's hurt feelings or punishment or
it's not I'm super getting too clear. Close. I always read it as his feelings were hurt and I'm getting too close to an employee and like this is not kosher for the prime minister.
But she takes a risk, and unlike the cue cards on the doorstep, when she sends Hugh Grant a card and she's vulnerable at Christmas time, I think that one's actually rather beautiful.
Yeah, totally appropriate.
Because he's not married or taken or in a committed relationship. It matters. And so I love his commitment of going door to door to find her and everything.
Right. The moment when the security guard starts singing and he's this beso profundo and Hugh Grant's face, just that.
When the snow lay round about.
Is so amazing.
What these two are going to need to go the distance, she can't be his employee. They have to be equals, and they're going to need to do a lot of talking to see if they are on the same page as far as goals, because he has great ambitions. He's freaking prime minister. Are they compatible? Because the Beatles were wrong when they said all you need is love. You also need shared goals. You need common interests, and you need shared values about what you want out of life. So they're going to need to sort that all out if they're going to last. But on chemistry, they're off to a great start.
Absolutely.
Number three is Jamie and Aurelia.
I love this storyline. It's just so sweet.
It's very sweet. And I would love to believe that you could fall in love with somebody who doesn't speak your language and you don't speak there, but the sheer stars alignment, we're meant to be together, our chemistry is undeniable of it, would just carry the day. The reality is that these two would have challenges.
For sure.
But first of all, the actors sell it so well.
So well.
You know, this whole, we're saying the same thing, but at different languages, and it's really awkward. Right. What I do love is they see, even though he does check her out when she strips down to go get his pages, what it's really about is they see a shared intelligence and warmth in each other. The only reason this relationship works for me is that they both do the work to learn each other's language.
Right.
Good night,
Ari. Good night, Jamie.
Bonita Aurelia. Eu vir aqui para te pedir para casar. Comigo. Eu sei que ser louco porque mal te conheço, mas às vezes as coisas são muito claras para mim. Não preciso de prova. Eu viver aqui ou tu viver na Inglaterra comigo.
Portuguese is one of those languages that, like, when spoken fluently in a lovely manner, is absolutely gorgeous. And when spoken poorly by anyone else, it's horrible sounding.
Claro que eu pensar que tu dizes na. Mas é Natal e só queria saber.
Oh, pelo amor de Deus! Diz que sim, minha parvalhona!
Thank you. That will be nice. Yes. Is being my answer. Easy question.
O que é que tu disseste?
Sim, claro.
I do love the musical score of this film.
It is quite good.
Proposing marriage is a bit much. It's perfect for a movie. Don't get me wrong. I mean, it really hits me in the feels. But in real life, you should probably just ask her to dinner.
Yeah, you know, never been on a date. Only known each other for, 4 weeks?
Yeah, and now we can actually start kind of talking. So let's see if we have shared values, if we have shared interests, if we have shared goals.
We know they have shared values and interests because we've been reading the subtitles.
It's my favorite time of day. Driving you.
É parte mais triste do meu dia, deixá-lo.
they need to take some time to actually get to know each other, to mm-hmm. build a relationship of trust, to see if they can rely on each other, and if the other person actually is who they think they are.
Right.
At that point, they can enter into commitment. But, you know, it's great for a feel-good Christmas movie. Sure. Just don't pattern your life after it. Speaking of patterning your life, pornography. So this leads us to our number two couple.
I love this couple so much.
They are lighting stand-ins on an adult film. They are not even the main actors.
Yeah, I don't know if it's an adult film or what. I mean, I assume it is, because that's some pretty gnarly stuff. But
it's stuff we're not going to show on YouTube.
No.
Or even on our membership site.
Nope.
But what I do love about this relationship, if you had told me before I saw this movie that the couple who meets on an adult film set is going to have the healthiest couple relationship with this film, because they're number two. I'll tell you what number one is in a second. I would have said, I don't see it. But what's actually great about them is because what they do for a living is so, like, they become intimately familiar with each other's naked bodies in a very non-sexual way. Because mm-hmm. my understanding, maybe you can speak to this as Absolutely. Someone in the industry, filming sex scenes is not sexy.
Let me tell you about the least sexy thing that's ever happened in human history. Filming sex scenes. It is the worst. It's cold, usually, or it's too hot.
It's nice and warm in here.
Yeah, it's not always the case, is it?
I've worked on shows where we filmed nude scenes and sex scenes, and it's very uncomfortable, weird experience, because inevitably, no matter how well you do it, you're going to have at least 10 or 15 people on set, sometimes dozens.
Yeah.
And it's all of our jobs to be looking at you.
Yeah, while this is going
on. Like, how is the light on you? How is your hair? Is the makeup correct? Like,
I get self-conscious in my swimsuit at the public pool.
Sure, sure, sure. And that's, yeah, this is a bunch of people whose job it is to professionally judge you. Like, it's just, it's a whole thing.
What I love about this relationship is actually because they're filming intimate scenes together and they're naked, that's all just kind of like another day's work.
Where did you two meet?
So their relationship, paradoxically, isn't sexual.
No, not
it's
at all.
It's very much about being interested in who the other person is, getting to know their likes and their dislikes,
well,
their history.
They start talking about traffic, and then they're just having all these conversations.
And he's ironically, given what they're, you know, what they're rehearsing, he's such a gentleman about her comfort, about, you know, so he's like sweet. Warming his hands before he touches her.
Exactly.
He asks for consent to touch before he does stuff. But to me, their relationship is beautiful because he takes interest in who she is.
Yeah.
And what she likes, what she's into, what her background is. And she, in turn, responds to, this man is treating me, he's a gentleman.
Fine.
I promise I won't stop.
He's not treating me like an object.
Yeah. He's not treating me like an object. I mean, again, like a lot of the comedy comes from you would expect him to, given the circumstances, which
is playing completely against what you expect.
Now, I'm not saying they can't have a great sex life, but because sex is the focus of their work, in their relationship, they actually shy away from it in favor of actually bonding and connecting.
Right.
And because it's not about, oh my gosh, it's you naked. It's about, I'm really into you, and I'm excited to be close to you. Number one, the healthiest relationship in Love Actually is not even a romantic relationship.
I know which one it is.
It is a parent-child relationship with Daniel and Sam.
A step-parent stepchild.
Yeah, which...
Lovely.
And the glue between them is gone. The mother's gone. She passed away, but Daniel is now all that Sam has.
Right.
Right? And so I love this because Daniel is not judgmental. He seeks advice from family members. When Sam opens up to him about his feelings and his emotions, Daniel doesn't judge them or downplay them as being childish. He treats them as seriously as if he were talking to an adult friend.
Oh, yeah. No, Daniel obviously went to the My Neighbor Totoro parenting school of just like, yes and.
And when Sam tells him his dreams, I'm going to learn to play the drums in 2 weeks. Instead of saying that's impossible, he's like, okay, what do we need to do to make that happen?
I think it's brilliant. I think it's stellar.
It's absolutely beautiful. So let's take a look at an example. Sam is in love with a girl from his school.
Hey, Samuel. Can't sleep?
I got some terrible news today.
Let's have it.
Joanna's going back to America.
Your girl's American?
Yes, she's American. She's not my girl. And she's going back to America. That's the end of my life as I know it.
That is bad news. Well, we need Kate, and we need Leo, and we need them now. Come on.
Hold on.
I love that they're not watching some manly action movie.
Nope.
Do you trust me?
I trust you.
We're gonna lean into our feelings. We're not gonna escape them with explosions.
You trust me?
I trust you.
Fool!
And I'm still gonna be a dad.
I love the juxtaposition of romantic sexual touch with Kate and Leo, and this very paternal loving.
You know, Sammy, I'm sure she's unique and extraordinary, but.
Well, I just love that this normalizes that, like, you know, they've got their legs crossed over each other and they're just like schlumped together on a couch, and that's fine.
It was for Kate and Leo. There was for you. And there is for me. She's the one.
Fair enough. Her name's Joanna.
Yeah, I know. Same as Mom.
So he doesn't belittle, he doesn't minimize, he doesn't say you're just a kid. These emotions are really, are so real to him.
Yeah.
And instead of, I mean, he tries to brace him for heartbreak. There may be others out there for you. And the kid's like, no, she's the one. He's like, all right.
Okay.
Because in his dad brain, he's like, all right, well, I'm going to be here for him for this. And then odds are they're not going to end up happily ever after because they're kids, and I'm going to be here for him when that happens.
The next one and the next one.
Yeah, but I'm not going to like crush this right now.
Right.
And so I see this, and it's just so beautiful to me. Their relationship is the most healthy and wholesome, and I think they're really going to go the distance. What they need to do to keep going the distance, honestly, what we just described, just keep doing what they're doing.
Yeah.
This is literally the only relationship in this movie. And I guess the one just before this, where I don't really have any notes. Like, they're doing it right.
Yeah, just keep it up.
Okay, well, Love Actually, lots of messages, some of them great, some of them not so great, but has earned its place as a holiday classic. And even if we dumped on it, it's not going anywhere. We can't stop the juggernaut.
We cannot stop it. It is going to continue.
Now, if you've enjoyed this and you like what we're doing, please like, subscribe, click the bell. If you don't click the bell, you don't get the notifications, and you're going to miss videos. Every video is a gift to you. Unwrap it by clicking the bell.
Ding, ding.
So until next time,
I feel it in my fingers. I feel it in my toes. Christmas is all around you. So go on, let it snow.
Are those the words?
I honestly couldn't tell you.
And watch movies.
Hello, does Natalie live here?
No.
Right, fine. Thank you. Sorry to disturb.
Yeah, aren't you the Prime Minister?
Yes. In fact, I am. Merry Christmas.
Oh.